Detroit has gone definitely mad. And here are not only the reason for its frenzy, but also an assemblage of the maniacs in the throes of their affliction. Those tigers are the cause of it all. Now let's go back a bit to the beginning of this mental disturbance. When young Gordon Stanley Cochran was chosen to manage the Detroit baseball team last winter, he obligingly posed for our newsreel and told something of his plans for the coming year. Suppose we listen to the modest Mickey himself. Take the screen, Mike.
I am looking forward to the coming season with more eagerness than at any time since I started in professional baseball. Naturally, I have a lot of responsibility in the managerial post, but I will say for the Detroit baseball fans that we're going to have a hustling ball club out there and a colorful team that I am sure that you'll enjoy watching play. The league has been very well balanced up due to these recent trades in Chicago, and there's five or six clubs that have a chance. And I will promise that the Detroit club is going to be right in the thick of it.
After the spring training trip, those Tigers came home and opened the season on a raw April day. Of course, there were the customary parade and flag-raising ceremony, and naturally, a handsome trophy for the new manager. The faithful were gathered for that opening game, but little did they suspect that this group of youngsters would turn out to be sensational performers, playing brilliantly under the direction of Mickey Cochran. It was a good omen that Detroit should win the first home contest, should start right in on their determined march to the top of the American League. It didn't take the fans long to rally to the support of those Tigers. And countless other thousands, by the magic of radio, were also following their fortunes. There's Ty Tyson chatting with Auker and getting first-hand information that he will later broadcast to his vast public from the press box here at Navin Field. And here's Ty Tyson at the microphone.
First man up, Rogel. Hit a weak one back to the box and was tossed out. Wahlberg to Morgan. Pitcher to first. Gosselin. Line to Almada in right center. Owen flied high to Reynolds in left. No runs, no hits, and no errors. And at the end of the seventh inning, the score remains 1-0 in favor of Boston. This is WWJ, the Detroit News. This game comes to you as usual through the courtesy of the White Star Refining Company, marketers of mobile gas and mobile oil.
By midsummer, it was plainly evident that those Tigers were going places. Under the inspired leadership of Mickey Cochran, they were winning plenty of ballgames. Confident that at last a pennant was coming to Detroit after 25 long, lean years, the town, the time this doubleheader was played on the 4th of July, was absolutely screwy. And incidentally, this holiday crowd was the largest of the season to date, and the second largest ever to pack into the park. Plays like this, in which Gehringer scored, gave the frantic thousands plenty of thrills. The team had a most successful stay at home. And then in August, it took to the road for a long eastern trip, on which, experts agreed, depended whether those Tigers were going to win the pennant. Reluctantly, the fans left Navin Field to wait an anxious month for the return of the team. One of baseball's most exciting days this season, barring a World Series game, was this one in the Yankee Stadium, when Detroit won both games of a doubleheader from New York. There were 78,000 men and women in the stands for the opening battle in this crucial series between the two pennant contenders. Among them, several hundred Detroiters, many of whom went to New York just to see their idols humble the Yanks. And what a series it was, with Detroit winning three out of the five games played and leaving Manhattan even more firmly entrenched in first place. Yes, sir, there was no joy in Ruthville, as they call the right field bleachers at the Yankee Stadium, when the lads from the Middle West got through showing those Gothamites just how it's done. A few days later came that disastrous afternoon in Scheib Park, Philadelphia, when schoolboy Rowe attempted to extend his record-tying string of victories to 17 games. But it just wasn't his day. And the end came when Bing Miller doubled and three runs scored. Then one September evening, hundreds of the faithful of fandom gathered at the railway station to welcome home those Tigers. They left four games ahead of the Yankees, and they came back five games ahead. The band played, and the throng cheered the conquering heroes as they left the terminal. They greeted Goose Gosselin and also Patsy O'Toole, the big bellow of Navin Field. Every member of the team received a salvo, but the greatest ovation was reserved for the boss himself, Mickey Cochran. Then began a long homestand in which those Tigers battled to maintain their lead. By now, not only Detroit, but the whole state of Michigan, not at the park, was hearing the broadcast of the game, listening to Harold True, who substituted for Harry Hallman when the former Tiger fell ill. How many heard those broadcasts? Well, suppose you count them. At any rate, this is how one Detroit street was lined with listeners.
Cochran then dumped a bunt down the third baseline, which was fielded nicely by Werber, who tossed him out at first, JoJo White reaching second safely. Gehringer then doubled sharply into left field, scoring White, and Goslin, the next man up, singled through shortstop, scoring Gehringer and tying up the old ball game. Rogel then popped up to Werber at third base, and Greenberg, the next man in the lineup, singled to center, but the goose was caught sliding into third on a beautiful throw by Almada to third base. That ends the inning with two runs, four hits, no errors, and two men left on base, and the ball game is all tied up. And may we remind you, ladies and gentlemen, that these games are brought us through the courtesy of the White Star Refining Company and its allied mobile gas and mobile oil dealers. This is the Michigan Radio Network, broadcasting through WXYZ with studios in the Maccabees Building, Detroit.
Day after day, those Tigers were out there, warming up bright and early for the impending contest, grimly going about the business of preparing to win a ballgame behind the splendid Tiger pitching staff that includes Fred Marbury, Tommy Bridges, Elon Hogsett, Vic Sorrell, Eldon Auker with his submarine delivery, Luke Hamlin, and the schoolboy. "How'm I doing, Edna?" he seems to be saying. And sure enough, there's Edna watching her Linwood. Charlie Gehringer, Leon the Goose Goslin, Joiner JoJo White, and Henry Greenberg, Mickey Cochran and Rudy York, Greeny with that mitt of his as big as a hot water bottle. There's Lanky Hank at batting practice. Bill Rogel picks out a bat that just suits his mood. Marvin Owen in his position at the hot corner, as the ball players call third base. Ray Hayworth, who relieves the boss behind the plate. And now we see the two men who were added to the 1933 team to make it the championship outfit of 1934, Mickey Cochran and Goose Goslin. And there's the goose swinging at one. Gerald Walker selects a bat that's guaranteed to have a base hit in it. JoJo White getting limbered up for the day's game. And Pete Fox is out there, too, playing catch. Frank Doljak, just thinking about things in general. And now, ladies and gentlemen, those Tigers. There's a fine, clean lot of athletes for you. How about giving them a hand?